I guess I started to go into the direction of filmmaking, and in particular documentary films, after I had the experience working and studying journalism, photography, and finally when I came to ethnographic film, I felt that I really found kind of the work that I felt like really in love with, and I decided that that would be something that I would give my full commitment to. So I had this this long interest, and living back in Vietnam, I really wanted to access material like the old archives in Vietnam. But you know, Vietnam is it's a very controlled country, so it's the access to all this material is very, very difficult. And working as an independent person, filmmaker or artist, you don't really get so much material or access to material, and so I just have to try to find a way of like whatever I can get hold of. So for the past few years, the access to material became more and more like accessible on the internet. Like there are like online archives, and you can even find many things maybe on eBay, people selling home movies, and just like very wide range of material that now became available. Shortly after I came back to Vietnam, I became very interested in the artist movement in the late 50s in Vietnam. That movement was started very soon after Vietnam gained independence from the French, and all these artists they actually fought for the revolution, and but after we gained the independence, they started to demand for their freedom of expression, and but the situation in Vietnam in the late 50s was very complicated, and the Communist Party also had to kind of started to prepare for the war. So so they, and also with like influence from other countries like China or Russia, that they started to really crackdown on the movement and this kind of artists. So as a result of that, like a lot of these artists had to either like go to prison or just completely like stop their practice for many decades, and that was like really a huge loss for Vietnam, both in terms of artistic continuity, and but also in terms of freedom of expression for many decades until very recently. In Vietnam, there was just kind of like one way of making artwork, like, you know, to serve socialism and kind of like, you know, propaganda works, and that is still like kind of very strongly influenced even now, and it's difficult to get rid of, and also the situation of censorship in Vietnam is still very strong, both for people to make work and but especially for people to exhibit or to publish their work. So I was very interested in this movement, and I wanted to document the artists who still survive from that period. And that research really influenced me. And for other projects that I continue until now, censorship and freedom of expression only kind of emerged as the main issue. Many times I didn't plan at the beginning for that issue to become significant, but the reality in Vietnam was seen that way, and also working as an artist in the that kind of situation kind of forced me to have to deal with that myself. So I found a lot of connection and similar kind of issues with the artists, even from more than half a century ago. Like for example, like one work that I was very very frustrated about the censorship and the control of the police with the art space that I work with, and they banned, you know, the exhibitions there, and I was very frustrated at that point. And I made this work of video installation, and I invited all the artists to each one to choose a piece of food and just eat it for the whole time, and I filmed them. And then in the installation, I put them all together, and everyone was eating something very quietly. And after they eat the food, they say their name and they say what they just ate. Kind of like stating the obvious. So for example, that kind of work, like if the police did come, but they didn't find any problem with it. And on the surface, it looks very quiet, and it didn't really say anything much. But actually, it was really about the situation of control and censorship.